At the end of November, winter is indeed coming, and the people of Europe have stood out as one of world's focuses.
Europe is entering a severe crisis.
It's going to be a long, cold, and dark winter for Europe.
And yet citizens are wondering if they're going to be able to heat their homes when the weather turns cold.
And things are getting tougher.
The consequences for households and companies are not sustainable anymore.
Germany has switched off street lights.
Businesses are shutting down.
Electricity bills are soaring, gas reserves are depleting, and winter is coming.
French supermarkets will switch off illuminated billboards, shortening heating hours at workplaces.
Prohibitive bills, power outages, energy crisis, and yes, this is Europe we're talking about, given that EU is one of the most powerful economies in the world. Let's dig deeper to find out what went wrong in Europe's environmental-friendly yet ambitious energy agenda. I'm Saina, and welcome to Factstown. So what's really happened? In this episode, I don't want to talk about something you already know. The breakout of the Russia-Ukraine conflict, Europe's dependence on Russian energy, and the mysterious blowouts of Nord Stream pipes. I want to talk about something else, something that started way earlier than it all began. To start with, one thing worth noticing is that this is not the first cold winter Europeans have been thrown into. This is going to be the third winter with significant spikes in the prices of electricity and natural gas, as well as gas shortages. So what happened? Why all of a sudden Europeans were unable to warm their houses during winter? Well, this has something to do with the introduction of the European Green Deal in 2019, the main guidance for the EU to transition its energy policy. To be honest, I think it's a great and grand deal, with its objective aiming to become the first climate-neutral continent by 2050. But to achieve such a goal, some serious works must be done. For example, since the production and the use of energy account for more than 75% of the EU's greenhouse gas emissions, so European politicians were looking to intensively overhaul the energy sector. But they have to do it fast, because they only give them 30 years to do so. And there are some also interim goals they want to achieve as well, in which by 2030, the EU wants to cut at least 40% of greenhouse gas emissions, realizing a 32% share for renewable energy and improve by more than 30% in energy efficiency. Active and aspiring, it's like the EU is a class of students who all want to get really high scores in the subject of climate, with these A-plus students leading the whole group. And with such a tight schedule they set for themselves, countries are immediately moving to two main areas: abandon fossil fuels and embrace renewable energy sources. But sometimes, more haste, less speed. It was Europe's extreme desire for these goals in such a short period of time that somehow set a stage for its future crisis. On the one hand, Europe was closing down coal plants at a furious pace. In March 2021, of the 324 coal plants in Europe, 162 had closed or confirmed to be retired by 2030, marking the halfway point in the campaign to retire all coal plants by 2030 at the latest. And looking at this graph again lays out their commitments to phase out coal with declines in both its usage and production. But let's take a look at the fossil energy domestic production in Europe. We can see that in this dynamic graph that the production of solid fossil fuels in Europe has significantly declined from 2010 to 2020. And the production of natural gas and crude oil has also dropped sharply. The hidden danger, however, is that at the same time, Europe's demand for these fossil fuels still remains high. According to the EU, its final energy consumption in 2020 shows that fossil fuels, including solid fossil fuels, natural gas, and oil and petroleum products, together accounted for about 60% of the total energy consumption. And here we're not talking about some tedious technical terms. We're talking about the quality of people's lives, factories being shut down, and the whole society needing fossil fuels to function properly. So the EU's economy and society are still highly dependent on fossil fuels. Yet they have been doing for years, as we have discussed, is the complete opposite, rapidly reducing their fossil fuel production because the clock is ticking. But they've seemingly missed a point. The energy transition must first reduce the demand for such fuels, not the supply. Cutting down supply while the demand is still strong will only make their supply chain more vulnerable.
This may not be a crisis just for this winter. This could be a multi-winter crisis, because if there is no gas going forward, Europe is going to have a huge supply problem going forward, even with this infrastructure buildup, because again, there's not a lot of additional gas in the system. I was just in Norway. The Norwegians have really raised their oil and gas production by close to 10%, but they are saying we're number one supplier to Europe for now, but we don't know how much more we can do. We're pretty much tapped out. So that is a real challenge, is there's just not a lot of additional gas volumes out there.
And it's practically the same situation with nuclear power, with plants being shut down across the continent. Some may say, you know what, the EU has invested so heavily in renewables like solar, wind, and hydropower. And don't get me wrong, we all want to see investments pay off. But living in the real world, the reality is not sometimes how we expect it to be, especially in a short time. And there are so many reasons why, given that people are working extremely hard, renewables still have a long way to go regarding technology, infrastructure, prices, and so on. If you guys are interested in this topic, let me know and we can dive into it with another episode. But let's go back to what we're talking about. Renewables only account for a small fraction of the EU's final energy consumption in 2020, while their curve increased only slightly over the past three decades. A sound person with a reasonable mind will ask if the EU is ready to replace all fossil fuels.
Well, it's a self-inflicted wound to a large extent. Obviously, the Russian situation has made it much more acute. But when you basically shut down your production capability in nuclear, coal, and gas, and try to transition immediately to alternative source energies, it doesn't work. It simply doesn't work. The people who are most harmed, of course, are the low-income and moderate-income individuals who are on fixed incomes and can't adjust to a massive increase in their energy bill, which is being driven in large part by stupid public policy on the issue of global climate change.
Indeed, less and less domestic energy production, but stable domestic demand have forced European countries to rely heavily on energy imports to sustain their industrial and social development. And this makes Europe's energy system quite fragile, as if it can easily break if the international situation were to take a relatively unusual turn, just like what's currently happening. And when it breaks, it creates a crisis that's hard to escape. Because of the sanctions on Russia, the EU's major energy supplier, a large energy shortfall has forced the EU to switch to other suppliers, such as Qatar. However, the EU's aggressive carbon-neutral targets have thrown a wrench into the deal again. Qatar wants long-term contracts, while the EU only sees fossil fuels as a short-term transition. Yet the energy market, in most cases, is a seller's market. Qatar has the option of selling its energy to other buyers, such as those in Asia, who are also facing a severe winter. As a result, negotiations between the EU and Qatar have also faltered.
Right. I mean, this is the big conundrum, is if we have a cold winter, not only in Europe, but in Asia, and they bid away these volumes. I mean, as you know, think about Qatar, huge natural gas supplier. Their volumes are largely under long-term contract to Asia. If you have Asia actually entering the spot market and competing with Europe for volumes, that is only going to make it that much more challenging for Europe to get through winter.
Meanwhile, the EU, fearful of energy prices that may surge again this winter, wants to impose caps to control the price. However, the proposal is not only opposed by energy professionals, but also debated within EU. Countries like Germany are skeptical of it and argue that this could not only disturb the market, but also lead to energy security problems, because again, the current energy market listens to the sellers.
I don't understand price caps being imposed by consumers on suppliers when the suppliers are holding the whip hand at the moment because of the huge demand we're seeing and the imbalances in the market. Do you understand it?
No, I don't understand that logic in general, okay? Price caps are always boomerangs. the point.
What do you mean by that boomerang?
I mean that those that impose price caps are unaware of what happens after that. Typically, there are always reactions that are worse than the problem that needs to be cured.
So the EU is probably missing the point by focusing on price, and now might be a good time for them to rethink their energy policy. And I mean, not just them. Every politician who wants to make policies regarding climate change should learn something, whether it's for developing or developed countries. Tackling climate change is much harder and more intricate than we thought. Making good policies takes dedication, prudence, objectiveness, and a whole lot of effort in finding the right pace for your economy. Climate protection may as well be a common value for all human beings, but so is the ability to afford bills, have a warm house in the winter, and not worry so much about power cuts. And what the public truly needs are definitely not some piecemeal remedies, such as hastily backtracking on some promises and quickly bringing back some nuclear and coal plants. We need reliable and realistic energy policies and systems that could benefit people who live now and in the future. That's it for today. If you like our show, please remember to click like and subscribe. We also open our new channel on Telegram. Be sure to check that out as well. I'm Saina. I'll see you guys next time. Bye for now.